Will Durant, an American historian, said, "It is true that even across the Himalayan barrier, India has sent to the West such gifts as grammar and logic, philosophy and fables, hypnotism and chess, and above all, numerals and the decimal system. I hope these lines will just guide you to understand on which topic we are going to discuss in detail. It's Indian scientific tradition, medieval and modern." Sayyid al-Andalusi, a leading natural philosopher of the 11th century, Muslim Spain, wrote, "The first nation to have cultivated science is India. This is a powerful nation, having a large population and a rich kingdom. India is known for the wisdom of its people. Over many centuries, all the kings of the past have recognized the ability of Indians in all branches of knowledge. The emphasis in the above quotation is not an Indian being, the first nation to cultivate science. It is on the fact that the European scholars, as late as the 11th century, thought India as a leader in science and technology. This is in contrast with the modern common perception about India in the Western minds or with the colonial period. Science happens when people seek to discover and learn about the world and their place in that world. These people formulate theories, test hypotheses, examine issues, manipulate experiments, and eventually apply the knowledge to gain and to improve in life. Regardless of the type of systems explored, physical, chemical, or biological, the work and the thoughts are accomplished at the hands and in the minds of the people, both individually and in terms in the group. In order to gain a sound appreciation and respect for the achievements of the Indian science, one needs an introduction to the people who made it happen across the pages of history. People are the priority of the science, both to carry it out, to benefit from its occurrence. If we just go back into the history of mathematics in India, the Vedang Jyotish in 1000 BC includes a statement, just as a feather of a peacock and the jewel stone of a snake are placed at the highest point of the body, at the forehead, similarly the position of Ganit is the highest among all branches of Vedas and the Shastras. The Sanskrit word used for mathematics in this verse is Ganit, which literally means reckoning. What is unique about the classical Indian views of mathematics is that number was treated as a primary concept, not as a geometry, as with the Greeks. A distinguished Swiss mathematician physicist wrote in 1929 that Occidental mathematics has in past centuries broken away from the Greek view and followed a course which seems to have originated in India, where the concept of number appears as logically prior to the concept of geometry. After quick adoption in 9th century Baghdad, it came slowly to be transmitted to Christian Europe around the 13th century through Jewish scholars working in Islamic Spain. This is illustrated in the works of distinguished scholars, the Persian mathematicians Al-Khwarizmi, who worked in the House of Wisdom at Baghdad. Apart from numbers, the idea of equations, in particular of algebraic equations, might also have come from India, with some very important contribution from West Asia. The use of symbols for unknown quantities and for arithmetical operations, addition, subtraction, multiplications, and divisions, and a statement of equality between appropriate expressions involving those symbols for both operations and unknown. When we talk about the spread of Indian mathematics outside India, the study of mathematics appears to slow down after the onslaught of the Islamic invasion and the conversion of the colleges and universities to madrasas. But this was also the time when Indian mathematical texts were increasingly being translated into Arabic and Persian. Although Arab scholars relied on a variety of sources, including Babylonian, Syrian, Greek, and some Chinese texts, Indian mathematical texts played a particularly important role. Scholars like Ibn Tariq and Al-Fazari, 8th century in Baghdad, Al-Khindi, 9th century Basra, Al-Khwarizmi, 9th century Khiva, Al-Kayarwani, 9th century Maghrib, author of Kitab Fi Al-Hisab Al-Hindi, Al-Uqdisi, 10th century Damascus, author of the book of chapters in Indian arithmetic, Ibn Sina, Avicenna, Ibn al-Samha, Granada, 11th century Spain, Al-Nasavi, Khurasan, 11th century Persia, Al-Biruni, 11th century, born Khiva, died in Afghanistan, Al-Razi, Tehran, and Ibn al-Safar, 11th century, Cordoba, were amongst the many who based their own scientific text on translation of Indian treatises. Records of the Indian origin of many proofs, concepts, and formulations were obscured in the later centuries. But the enormous contribution of Indian mathematics was generously acknowledged by several important Arabic and Persian scholars, especially in Spain. Abbasid scholar Al-Gahith wrote, "India is a source of knowledge, thought, and insight." Al-Ma'undi, 956 AD, who travelled in Western India, also wrote about the greatness of Indian science. Said Al-Andosi, an 11th century Spanish scholar and court historian, was amongst the most enthusiastic in his praise of Indian civilization, and specially remarked on Indian achievements in the sciences and in mathematics. Of course, eventually, Indian algebra and trigonometry reached Europe through a cycle of translation, traveling from the Arab world to Spain and Sicily, and eventually penetrating all of Europe. At the same time, Arabic and Persian translations of Greek and Egyptian scientific texts become more readily available in India. Simultaneously, a school which was there in South India was gaining popularity for a wonderful reason, the Kerala school. Although it appears that original work in mathematics ceased in much of northern India after the Islamic conquest, Banaras as a center survived for mathematical study, and an important school of mathematics blossomed in Kerala. Madhava, 14th century, places Kochi, made important mathematical discoveries that would not be identified by European mathematicians till at least two centuries later. His series expansions of the cos and sine functions anticipated Newton's by almost three centuries. Historians of mathematics, Rajagopala, Rangachari, and Joseph, considered his contribution instrumental in taking mathematics to the next stage, that of modern classical analysis. Nilkantha, 15th century, Tirur in Kerala, extended and elaborated upon the results of Madhava, while Jyeshtadeva, 16th century Kerala, provided detailed proof of the theorems and derivations of the rules contained in the works of Madhava and Nilkantha. It is also notable that Jyeshtadeva's Yukti Bhasha, which contains commentaries on Nilkantha's Tantra Samgraha, included elaborations on planetary theories later adopted by Taicho Brahe, the mathematics that anticipated work by later Europeans. Chitrabhanu, 16th century in Kerala, gave integer solutions to 21 types of system of two algebraic equations using both algebraic and geometric methods in developing his results. Important discoveries by the Kerala mathematicians included the Newton's-Gauss interpolations formula, the formula for the sum of an infinite series and a series notation for pi. The Indian numeral system and its place value, decimal system of enumerations, came to the attentions of the Arab in the 7th or 8th century and served as a basis for the well-known advancement in Arab mathematics, represented by figures such as Al-Khwarizmi. It reached Europe in the 12th century when Adelard of Bath translated Al-Khwarizmi's works into Latin. But the Europeans were at first resistant to the system, being attached to the far less logical Roman numeral system. But the eventual adoption of the system led to the scientific revolution that began to sweep Europe beginning in the 13th century. Let's do about the contribution of Madhava in detail. Madhava, the Kerala region of South India, was a home to this prominent school of mathematics, and the best known member of the school, Madhava, time period is 1444 to 1545, who lived in Sangamagrama in Kerala, primarily an astronomer. He made history in mathematics with his writings on trigonometry. He calculated the sine, cos and arctangent of the circle, developing the world's first consistent system of trigonometry. He also correctly calculated the value of p to 11 decimal places. This is by no means a complete list of influential Indian mathematicians or Indian contributions to mathematics, but rather a survey of the highlights of what is judged by any fair, unbiased standard, an illustrious tradition important both for its own internal elegance as well as its influence on the history of European mathematical tradition. The classical Indian mathematical renaissance was an important precursor to the European renaissance, and to ignore this fact is to fail to grasp the history of Latin, a history which was truly multicultural, deriving its inspiration from a variety of cultural roots. Professor C. K. Raju, a renowned scholar, has researched the clash of epistemologies that occurred in European ideas about number. When Europeans started to import Indian ideas about mathematics, what had been natural to Indian thinkers for a long time was very hard for Europeans to accept. He divided this reaction into three periods. The first math war is Europe was from 10th to 16th century, during which time it took Europe 500 years to accept the zero because the church considered it to be heresy. The second math war was over the Indian concept of indivisibles, which led to the theory of real numbers and infinitesimals, paving the way for the development of calculus. This war lasted 3 centuries, from 17th to 19th century. The third math war is now underway and is between computational maths, Indian algorithmic approach, and formal maths, Western approach. The next branch in the scientific tradition is astronomy. The source for astronomical knowledge are Jyotish Vedanga, which was written in 500 BC, and Pancha Siddhantas, of which Surya Siddhanta, Varaha Mihir 578 AD, has had a major influence on Indian astronomical tradition. Similarly, the postulation of atomism in the Nyaya Vaisheshikas, the extensive treatise on coinage and minting in Kautilya's Arthashastra, and the holistic science of life, Ayurveda, with its outstanding text, the Charak Susruta and Ashtanga Samhita, are examples of advanced scientific knowledge that was available during the medieval period, which is roughly around 647 to 1526 AD. The Jantar Mantar Astronomical Observatory in Jaipur, Rajasthan, which was built in early 18th century by the astronomer King Savai Jaisingh II. Let's just cover few scientific development which took place in the medieval, late medieval age, continued to the modern time. In brief, Akbarnama, written by Abul Fazl in 1602, depicts the defeat of Baj Bahadur of Malwa. by the Mughal troops in 1561. The Mughals extensively improved metal weapons and armors used by the armies of India. That was an achievement. Second is indigo, which was used as a dye in India, which was also a major center for its production and processing. The indigo ferra, tinctoria, variety of indigo was domesticated in India. Indigo used as a dye made its way to the Greeks and the Romans via various trade routes and was valued as a luxury product. Third in the line is the Kashmiri wool. Fiber, also known as the Pashmina, was used in the handmade shawls of Kashmir. The woolen shawls from Kashmir region find written mention between 3rd century BC and 11th century CE. The founder of the Kashmir wool industry is traditionally held to be 15th century ruler of Kashmir, Janul Abidin, who introduced weavers from Central Asia. Next development is crystallized sugar, which was discovered by the time of Gupta dynasty, and the earliest reference to candied sugar comes from India. Jute was also cultivated in India. Muslin was named after the city where Europeans first encountered it, Mosul, in what is now Iraq. But the fabric actually originated from Dhaka, which is now in Bangladesh. In the 9th century, an Arab merchant named Suleiman makes note of material's origin in Bengal, known as Ruhmul in Arabic. Evidence of inoculation and the dose which was available for smallpox is also found in 8th century when Madhav wrote the Nidan, a 79 chapter book which lists diseases along with their causes, symptoms, complications. He included a special chapter on smallpox, Masurika, and described the method of inoculations to protect against smallpox. European scholar Francisco I reproduced a number of Indian maps in his magnum opus La Cartographia Antica del India. Out of all these maps, two have been reproduced using a manuscript of Lok Prakasha, originally compiled by the polymath Shemendra in Kashmir 11th century CE as a source. The other manuscript used as a source by Francisco I is titled Samgrahani. The infinite series or infinite series of pi was stated by Madhav of Sangamagrama 1340 to 1425, and his Kerala school of astronomy and mathematics made use of the series expansion of arctangs to obtain an infinite series expression now known as Madhava Gregori series for pi. The development of the series expansion for trigonometric functions sine, cosine and arctangent was carried out by mathematicians of the Kerala school in the 15th century CE. Their work, completed 2 centuries before the invention of calculus in Europe, provided what is now considered the first example of a power series apart from geometric series. Next in line is Sher Shah of Northern India, who issued silver currency bearing Islamic motifs, later imitated by the Mughal Empire. The Chinese merchant Ma Huan, 1413-51, noted that gold coins, which were known as Fanam, were issued in Cochin and weighed a total of 1 fen and 1 li according to the Chinese standard. They were of fine quality and could be exchanged in China for 15 silver coins of 4 li weight each. Next invention is of the seamless celestial globe, which was invented in Kashmir by Ali Kashmiri Ibn Luqman in 998 AH, corresponding to 1589-90 CE, and 20 other such globes were later produced in Lahore and Kashmir during the Mughal Empire. Before they were rediscovered in 1980s, it was believed by modern metallurgists to be technically impossible to produce metal globes without any seam, even with modern technology. These Mughal metallurgists pioneered the method of lost wax casting in, or it was written in Tariq-e-Firishta, 1606 to 1607, that the envoy of the Mughal ruler, Hulegu Khan, was presented with a pyrotechnic display upon his arrival in Delhi in 1258 CE as a part of an embassy to India by Timurid leader Shah Rukh, 1405 to 1447, Abd al-Razzaq mentioned naphtha throwers mounted on elephants and a variety of pyrotechnics put on display. Next invention is of the firearms, known as topotufuk, also existed in the Vijayanagar Empire by as early as 1366 EC. From then on, the employment of the gunpowder warfare in the region was prevalent, with events such as the siege of Belgaum in 1473 CE by the Sultan Muhammad Shah Behmani. Next invention, Fatullah Shirazi, c. 1582, a Persian Indian polymath and mechanical engineer who worked for Akbar in the Mughal Empire, invented the autocannon, the earliest multi-shot gun. In A History of Greek Fire and Gunpowder, James Riddick Partington described Indian rockets, mines and other means of gunpowder warfare. The Indian war rockets were formidable weapons before such rockets were used in Europe only. They had bamboo rods, a rocket body lashed to the rod and iron points. They were directed at the target and fired by lighting the fuse. But the trajectory was rather erratic. The use of mines and countermines with explosive charges of gunpowder is mentioned for the times of Akbar and Jahangir too. By the 16th century, Indians were manufacturing a diverse variety of firearms. Large guns in particular became visible in Tanjore, Dhaka, Bijapur, Murshidabad. Guns made of bronze were recovered from Calicut in 1504, Diu in 1533. Gujarat supplied Europe saltpeter for use in gunpowder warfare during 17th century. Bengal and Malwa participated in saltpeter production. The Dutch, French, Portuguese and English used Chhapra as a center of saltpeter refining. Next invention in this category can be of the construction of waterworks, an aspect of water technology in India, which is described in Arabic and Persian works too. During medieval times, the diffusion of Indian and Persian irrigation technology gave rise to an advanced irrigation system, which brought about economic growth and also helped in the growth of material culture. The scholar Sadiq Isfahani of Jaunpur compiled an atlas of the parts of the world which he held to be suitable for human life. It's 32 sheet atlas with maps oriented towards the south, as was the case with Islamic works of the era, is part of a larger scholarly work compiled by Isfahani during 1647 CE. The largest known Indian map depicting the former Rajput capital at Amber is remarkable house by house detail, measures 661 into 645 centimeter approximately. Early volumes of the Encyclopedia Britannica describe cartographic charts made by seafaring Dravidian people and the gunpowder technology in 18th century Mysore. It's quite commendable. When we just talk about India's contribution to science and technology, we just have to divide that into subcategory. Let's start with the textile first. Indian textile have been legendary since ancient time. The Greeks and Romans extensively imported textile from India. Roman archives record official complaints about massive cash drainage due to these imports from India. One of the earliest industries relocated from India to Britain was textile, and it became the first major success of the Industrial Revolution, with Britain replacing India as the world's leading textile exporter. What is suppressed in the discourse about India and Europe is the fact that the technology, designs and even the raw cotton were initially imported from India, while in parallel India's indigenous textile mills were outlawed by the British. India's textile manufacturers were delicensed, even tortured in some cases, overtaxed and regulated, to civilize them into virtual extinction. Textile and steel were the mainstay of the British Industrial Revolution. Both had their origin in India. The Ahmedabad Textile Museum is a great resource for scholarly material. Next in line is iron steel. Iron is found in countries neighboring India, leading European scholars to assume that it came from outside India. Cemeteries in present-day Balochistan have iron objects. The earlier iron found in Middle Eastern archaeological sites was essentially meteorite material sculptured as rock or stone carving and was not metallurgically processed at all. Since iron can be a byproduct of copper technology, this could be its likely origin in India, because copper was a well-known technology in many parts of ancient India. A smelting furnace, which is dated approximate 800 BCE, is found in Naikund in Maharashtra, India. Recent discovery revealed that iron was known to the Ganga Valley in mid-second millennium BCE. In the mid-first millennium BCE, the Indian wood steel was very popular in Persian courts for making swords. Rust-free steel was an Indian invention and remained an Indian skill for centuries. Delhi's famous iron pillar, dated 402 CE, is considered a metallurgical marble and shows minimum signs of rust. The famous Damascus steel swords, now displayed in museums across Europe, were made from Indian steel imported by Europeans. The acclaimed Sheffield steel in the UK was Indian crucible steel. The best brain of European science worked for decades to learn to reverse engineer how Indians made crucible steel. And in this process, modern alloy design and physical metallurgy was developed in Europe. Indian industry was dealt a dead blow by the colonial masters, who banned the production and manufacture of iron and steel at several places in India, fearing their use in making swords and other arms. In addition, they also ensured India would depend upon iron steel imported from Europe. Next metal, this category is the zinc metallurgy. Another important Indian contribution to metallurgy was in the isolation, distillations and use of zinc. From natural sources, zinc content in alloys such as brass can go no higher than 28%. These primitive alloys with less than 28% zinc were prevalent in many parts of the world before India. However, to increase the zinc content beyond this threshold, one must first separate the zinc into 100% pure form and then mix the pure zinc back into an alloy. A major breakthrough in the history of metallurgy was India's discovery of zinc distillation, whereby the metal was vaporized and then condensed back into pure metal. There is evidence of zinc ore mining at Zawar in Rajasthan from the 5th century BCE. But unfortunately, there is a lack of evidence of regular production of metallic zinc until the 8th century CE. The earliest confirmed evidence of zinc smelting by distillations is from Zawar. Europeans learned it for the first time in 1743 when know-how was transferred from India. Until then, India had been exporting pure zinc for centuries on an industrial scale. At archaeological site in Rajasthan, retorts used for the distillations are found in very large number even today. Once zinc had become separated into a pure metal, alloys could be made with the required zinc component to provide the required properties. For instance, strength and durability increases with higher zinc component. Also, copper alloy looks like gold when the zinc component is higher than 28%. Most early brass objects found in other countries had less than 10% zinc component, and therefore these are not based on zinc distillation technology. Three important items are now proven about the history of zinc metallurgy. 1. Zinc distillation and metallurgical uses was pioneered in India. 2. Industrial scale production was pioneered in Rajasthan. 3. England transferred the technology of zinc from India in 1736. British metallurgy documents do not mention zinc at all prior to this transfer. Next to this contribution side is the shipping and shipbuilding. Shipbuilding was one of India's major export industry until the British dismantled it and formally banned it. Medieval Arab sailors purchased their boats in India. The Portuguese also continued to get their boats from India, not from Europe. Some of the world's largest and most sophisticated ships were built in India and China. The compass and other navigation tools were already in use in the Indian Ocean long before Europe. Nav is the Sanskrit word for boat and is a root word in navigation and navy. Using their expertise in the science of seafaring, Indian participated in the earliest known ocean-based trading system. Few people know that an Indian naval pilot named Kanha was hired by Vasco da Gama to captain his ship and take him to India. Some of Europe's acclaimed discoveries in navigation were in fact appropriations of a well-established thriving trade system in the Indian Ocean. Contrary to the European portrayal that Indians knew only coastal navigation, deep sea shipping had existed in India, as Indian ships had been sailing to islands such as Andaman, Lakshadweep and Maldives around 2000 years ago. Cotillias describe the time that are good and bad for seafaring. There's also extensive archival materials on the Indian Ocean trade in Greek, Roman and Southeast Asian countries. Next in line is the forest management. Many interesting findings have recently come out about the way forests and trees were managed by each village and how a careful method was applied to harvest medicines, firewood and building materials in accordance with natural renewal rate. There is now a database being built of sacred groves across India. Once again, it's a story of an economic asset falling into disuse and abuse because of the dismantling of local governance and disrespect for traditional system. Furthermore, when scholars try to explain India's current ecological disaster, they seldom mention the large-scale logging of Indian timber by the British in order to fund the two world wars and various other industrial programs of the empire. When we do about the farming technique, Indian farmers developed non-chemical, eco-friendly pesticides and fertilizers that have modern application. These traditional pesticides have been recently revived in India with excellent results, replacing Union Carbide's product in certain markets. Crop rotation and soil technology that has been passed down for thousands of years are traditional practices which India pioneered. Historically, India's agricultural production was large and sustained a huge population compared to other parts of the world. Surpluses were stored for use in a drought year, but the British turned this industry into a cash cow, exporting very large amounts of grains even during food shortages. This caused tens of millions of Indians to die of starvation in the 19th century. Folk sciences. The distinction between elite and folk sciences was non-existent in ancient time. India's advanced metallurgy and civil engineering was researched and practiced by artisans' guilds. For instance, modern scientists have humbly admitted that the ecological management practiced today by the tribes of India's northeast is far superior to anything they could teach them. A good example is the use of alder, Alnus napolensis, which has been cultivated in the Jhum shifting cultivation fields by the Konoma farmers in Nagaland for centuries. It has multiple uses for the farmers since it is a nitrogen fixing tree and helps to retain the soil fertility. Its leaves are used as fodder and fertilizer and is also utilized as timber. One could cite numerous such examples. Myths and legends sometimes represent the attempt of our ancestors to explain the scientific observation they made about the world around them and transmitted these to the future. They chose different models to interpret the observation, but the observations were empirical. If we talk about metallurgy among the technologies, metallurgy in many ways holds pride of place. Excavations in the Indus Valley yielded the celebrated figure of a dancing girl cast in bronze some 4,000 years ago. India was a pioneer in the extraction of zinc. The process used in the Jawhar mines of the Rajasthan in northwestern India since the 4th century BCE, was later patented in 19th century Britain. The iron and steel industry throughout India dates from around 1300 BCE. Legend has it that one of the gifts that Alexander took from India during his raid was a ball of steel weighing nearly 15 kilograms. Smith, during the Gupta Empire, 4th to 5th century CE, created the much-studied iron pillar that stands today near the Qutub Minar in Delhi, over 7 meters tall and 6 tons in weight. It shows no sign of rust whatever. It was manufactured by forged welding a number of cylindrical stubs of the metal. From around 1000 CE, South Indian craftsmen began to cast superb bronze sculpture. The famous Damascus swords of West Asia were forged out of an Indian steel called woods, derived from the South Indian word wok, in a misprint that was never corrected. In the late 18th century, Tipu Sultan's rocket surprised British Army with a performance far exceeding anything then available in Europe, chiefly because of the excellence of the steel he used for the casing. Until late in the 18th century, India exported iron steel to England, being the only source apart from Sweden of high quality iron then known to the British. If we talk about the textile industry, which is the major industry associated with India for thousands of years, India was also at one time famous for boats and shipping. Although much Indian shipping stayed fairly close to the coast, Indian craftsmen displayed excellent skills in building ships. The best ships operated by the East India Company in the late 18th and early 19th century were usually made in the Bombay area. The first Indian to be elected to the Royal Society of London was a Parsi engineer, Ardasius Kursedzi, whose docks in Bombay built ships better than the British could at the time. Kursedzi managed to stay abreast of the industrial revolution in Britain and experimented with the use of steam engines for ship at about the same time as Europeans. War rockets developed by Hyder Ali, the Prince of Mysore, was also a big surprise. Hyder Ali, Prince of Mysore, developed war rockets with an important change: the use of metal cylinders to contain the combustion powder. Although the hammered soft iron he used was crude, the bursting strength of the container of the black powder was much higher than the earlier paper construction. Thus, a greater internal pressure was possible, with a resultant greater thrust of the propulsive jet. The rocket body was lashed with leather thongs to a long bamboo stick. Range was perhaps up to 3/4 of a mile, maybe more than a kilometer. Although individually these rockets were not accurate, the dispersion errors became less important when large numbers were fired rapidly in mass attacks. They were particularly effective against cavalry and were hurtled into the air after lighting or skimmed along the hard dry ground. Hyder Ali's son Tipu Sultan continued to develop and expand the use of rockets weapon, reportedly increasing the number of rocket troops from 1,200 to a corps of 5,000. In battles at Srirangapatnam in 1792 and in 1799, these rockets were used with considerable effect against the British. When we talk about the postal system, which is also a part of the scientific invention, by the end of 18th century, the postal system in the region had reached high levels of efficiency. According to Thomas Broughton, the Maharaja of Jodhpur sent daily offerings of fresh flowers from his capital to Nathdwara, which is approximately 320 kilometers, and they arrived in time for the first religious darshan at sunrise. Later, this system underwent modernization with the establishment of the British Raj. The Post Office Act 17th of 1837 enabled the Governor General of India to convey messages by post within the territories of East India Company. Mail was available to some officials without charge, which became a controversial privilege as the years passed. The Indian Post Office Service was established on October 1, 1837. The British also constructed a vast railway network in the region for both strategic and commercial reasons. If we talk about the contribution in the 19th and the 20th century, Raja Ramon Roy, as the father figure of the Indian Renaissance, emerges out loudly. As a British power spread across India in the 19th century, in part through the use of superior technology, Indian intellectual leaders, beginning with Raja Ramon Roy, realized that they needed to understand the revolution that had occurred in European knowledge system. Eventually, they created three major new institutions. The first was Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science, which was established in Calcutta in 1876 by the medical practitioner Mahendra Lal Sarkar. It was here that C.V. Raman later did the work in spectroscopy, for which he won the 1929 Nobel Prize in Physics. The second was the establishment of Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore by Jamshedji Tata, an industrialist from Bombay who saw long before others that a Western sense of the pursuit of science as an intellectual discipline was essential for the well-being of India and its industry. Although initially resisted by British commercial interests in India, the institute began work in 1909 till 1911. The third institution was Indian Science Congress, which held in 1914, the first of a series of annual meetings of all Indian scientists. These enterprises were quickly followed by a variety of other initiatives, and Indian scientists began to make a mark at the Presidency College of Madras and Calcutta, and in universities elsewhere, world attention was caught by the distinguished work of such scientists as J.C. Bose, who experimented with wireless transmission before Marconi, Meghnad Saha, whose law of ionizations can be considered the first theoretical effort in astrophysics, Nobel Prize winner C.V. Raman, and Satyendranath Bose, whose unusual statistics and work with Einstein led to a particle description of radiation. When we talk about Ramanujan, earlier the mathematical genius Ramanujan, time period is 1887 to 1920, had represented a response to Western mathematics that was in the traditional Indian idiom. His education was not above the pre-university level, and in mathematics was entirely limited to familiarity with the basic compilation of mathematical formulas found in British manuals. In particular, Ramanujan was non-Euclidean in the sense that he did not proceed with proofs of the kind that underlie Western mathematics. However, whether or not he was able to prove them, his results were almost always correct and astonishingly original, which made an enormous impression on Cambridge mathematician G.H. Hardy and his colleague. Ramanujan saw formulas in their entirety and often claimed that they were revealed to him by his family goddess in dream. Littleton, one of his Cambridge collaborators, remarked, "If a significant piece of reasoning occurred somewhere and the mixture of evidence and intuition gave him certainty, he," means Ramanujan, "looked no further." Ramanujan's brief career seemed to demonstrate to Indians that their innate scientific ability could make a mark even in the otherwise unfamiliar territory of Western mathematics. By the 1930s, there were several Indians with international reputation in science, but it was becoming increasingly clear that the opportunities available to them within the country were far too few. Bitter controversies erupted among scientific leaders who had to share very scarce resources. Probably the first great Indian scientist to flee the country in search of opportunity was a renowned astrophysicist, Chandrasekhar, Nobel Prize winner in 1983. He eventually settled down in Chicago after being at Cambridge in England. The trickle started in 1930s, grew by the 1970s into a westward flood of scientific talent that continues into the 21st century. Let's talk about the development of science in a free republic, India. With the end of British rule, the new Indian Republic, led by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru and his successors, took massive initiative for the growth of science, leading to the establishment of new institutions or the vigorous expansion of the older ones, including the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, the Department of Atomic Energy, the Defence Research and Development Organisation, the Indian Institute of Technology and Indian Space Research Organisation, among others. Pandit Nehru thought of these institutions and the dams and the factories that were built in the first decades of the new republic as modern temples. He was convinced that it was impossible to solve India's problem without the use of modern science and technology, and constantly spoke of promoting a scientific temper among the people. One major feature of Indian science and technology in Republican India has been the growth of strategic sector. The country began making relatively large investment in defense, atomic energy, space and other related areas. Agriculture was another sector that received massive support, and the major initiative taken in agriculture in 1960s turned the tide in a matter of 5 to 10 years. The sudden and somewhat unexpected growth of the computer software industry in India, plus the prominent role that non-resident Indians are playing in US scientific and technological enterprises, particularly in Silicon Valley, have drawn attention to Indian talent in terms that the US public can easily understand, perhaps the much discussed Indian prowess in software is really the most recent manifestation of the long Indian love affair with numbers. When we talk about interaction between colonial and the native sciences, the British education system, which always aimed at producing able civil and administrative services candidate, exposed a number of Indians to foreign institutions. For example, Sir Jagdish Chandra Bose, Satyendranath Bose, Meghnad Saha, P.C. Mahalanobis, C.V. Raman, Subramanyam Chandrasekhar, Homi Bhabha, Srinivas Ramanujan, Vikram Sarabhai, Hargobind Khurana and Harish Chandra were among the notable scholars of this period. Extensive interaction between colonial and native sciences was seen during most of the colonial era. Western science came to be associated with the requirement of nation building rather than being viewed entirely as a colonial entity, especially as it continued to fuel necessities from agriculture to commerce. Scientists from India also appeared throughout Europe. By the name or by the time of India's independence, colonial science had assumed importance within the westernized intelligentsia and establishment. Let's cover certain achievers in science and technology in modern India. In modern times, the contributions made by Sir C.B. Raman to the study of molecular scatterings of the light, by J.C. Bose to physiological response of plant to light, measuring extremely short intervals of time and rate of reaction, by Srinivas Ramanujan to mathematics, are noteworthy. Many a scientist followed and caught up with modern development, and now India is one of the great countries of scientific advancement in the world. Jayant Vishnu Nalikar, the astrophysicist who presented his new theory of gravitation and acclaimed as Indian Einstein, Dr. Swaminathan for his contribution to agricultural science and green revolution, D.Y. Subbarao for his discoveries of drugs, dihydrogen and oriumicin. How can we forget Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, a physicist considered to be the father of India's space program, who was instrumental in the creation of both the Indian Space Research Organization and Physical Research Laboratory at Ahmedabad. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister of India, initiated reforms to promote higher education, science, technology in India. The Indian Institute of Technology, conceived by a 22-member committee of scholars and entrepreneurs in order to promote technical education, was inaugurated on 18th August 1951 at Kharagpur in West Bengal by then Minister of Education Maulana Abul Kalam Azad. Beginning in the 1960s, close ties with the Soviet Union enabled the Indian Space Research Organization to rapidly develop the Indian Space Program and advance nuclear power in India, even after the first nuclear test explosion by India on May 18, 1974 at Pokhran. Jawaharlal Nehru aimed to convert India's economy into that of a modern state and to fit her into a nuclear age and do it quickly. Nehru understood that India had not been at the forefront of the Industrial Revolution and hence made an effort to promote higher education and science and technology in India. Nehru's Planning Commission in 1950 fixed investment levels, prescribed priorities, divided funds between agriculture and industry, divided resources between state and the federal governments, and the results of all these efforts between 1947 till 1962 saw the area under irrigation increases by 45 million acres, food production rise by 34 million metric tons, installed power generating capacity increased by 79 million kilowatts, and an overall increase of 94% industrial production. The enormous population rise, however, would balance the gains made by Nehru, but the economically beleaguered country was nevertheless able to build a large scientific workforce, second in numbers only to that of United States and Soviet Union. When we talk about enhancement of vocation technical skills, August 18, 1951, the Minister of Education, Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, inaugurated the Indian Institute of Technology at Kharagpur in West Bengal, possibly modelled after the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. These institutions were conceived by 22-member committee of scholars and entrepreneurs under the chairmanship of N.P. Sarkar. The Sino-Indian War 1962 came as a rude awakening to Nehru's military preparedness. Military cooperation with the Soviet Union, partially aimed at developing advanced military technology, was pursued during the coming years. Defence Research and Development Organisation was formed in 1958. Radio broadcasting was initiated in 1927, but became state responsibility only in 1930. In 1937, it was given the name All India Radio, and since 1957, it has been called Akashvani Limited. Duration of television programming became in 1959, and complete broadcasting followed in 1965. The Indian government required the EVS-EM computers from the Soviet Union, which was used in large companies and research laboratories. Tata Consultancy Services, established in 1968 by the Tata Group, were the country's largest software producers during the 1960s. When we talk about nuclear power, the period is specific period is 1967 to 1987. The roots of nuclear power in India lie in the early acquisition of nuclear reactor technology from a number of Western countries, particularly the American support for the Tarapur Atomic Power Station and Canada's CANDU's reactor. Stanley's Wolper, 2008, described the measures taken by the Indian government to increase agricultural output. It was not until the late 1960s that chemical fertilizers and high-yield food seed brought the Green Revolution to India. The results were mixed, as many poor or small farmers were unable to afford the seeds or the risk involved in the new technology. Moreover, as rice and especially wheat production increased, there was a corresponding decrease in other grain production. Farmers also benefited, most were from the major wheat growing areas of Haryana, Punjab, Western UP. The Indian space program received only financial support from the Soviet Union, which helped the Indian Space Research Organization achieve aims such as establishing the Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station, launching remote sensing satellite, developing India's first satellite, Aryabhatta, and sending astronauts into the space. India sustained its nuclear program during the aftermath of Operation Smiling Buddha, India's first nuclear test. Though the roots of Steel Authority of India Limited lie in Hindustan Steel Private Limited, 1954, the events leading up to the formation of the modern avatar can be summed up this way, that as soon as the Ministry of Steel and Mines drafted a policy statement to evolve a new model for managing industry, it was presented to the Parliament on December 2, 1972. On this basis, the concept of creating a holding company to manage inputs and outputs under one umbrella was mooted, and this led to the formation of Steel Authority of India. The company incorporated on January 24, 1973, with an authorized capital of rupees 2000 crores, was made responsible for managing 5 integrated steel plants at Bhilai, Bokaro, Durgapur, Rourkela and Burnpur. The alloy steel plant and the Salem steel plant. In 1978, SAIL was restructured as an operating company. India accounts for about 10% of all expenditure on research and development in Asia, and the number of scientific publications grew by 45% over the past 5 years. However, according to India's Science and Technology Minister, India is lagging in science and technology compared to developed countries. India has only 140 researchers per 1 lakh population compared to 4,651 in the United States. India invested approximately $3.7 billion in science and technology in the year 2002 and 3. For comparison, China invested about 4 times more than India, while United States invested approximately 75 times more than India on science and technology. Despite this, 5 Indian Institute of Technology were listed among the top 10 science and technology schools in Asia by Asia Week. However, the number of publications by Indian scientists is characterized by some of the fastest growth rates among major countries. India, together with China, Iran and Brazil, are the only developing countries among 31 nations with 97.5% of the world's total scientific productivity. The remaining 162 developing countries contribute less than 2.5% of the world's scientific output. Indian agriculture benefited from the development made in the field of biotechnology, for which a separate department was created in 1986 under the Ministry of Science and Technology. The effect of the technological inclined services sector, which includes the IT industry in India, accounting for 40% of India's GDP and 30% of export earning as of 2006, while employing only 25% of its workforce, is summarized by Sharma in the Encyclopedia of India. India holds observer status at CERN, while a joint India European Union Software Education and Development Center is due at Bangalore. The scene in India is continuing, it's progressing, and obviously it is uneven too. In spite of its size, India's presence in the world of science and technology is still small. The investment required to break into the world knowledge system is huge, and it appears both India and China will find it difficult to afford this for quite some time to come. In rough number, India accounts for about 0.5% of the total expenditure of the world on research and development and about 2% of the resulting publication. Today, the major problem is further development of India lies in learning to manage the extraordinary talent that the country possesses. India is often said to be home to one of the largest scientific communities in the world, but only a small percentage of those graduating in the science are doing research. Mark Twain made a beautiful comment on India, which is the best way to conclude this topic now. "So far as I am able to judge, nothing has been left undone, either by man or nature, to make India the most extraordinary country that the sun visits on his round. Nothing seems to have been forgotten, nothing overlooked." Thank you.